I hit here, you'll get all three cameras. We ready? We are in an undisclosed location interrogating Jim Osterberg about the Stooges, the greatest rock and roll band ever.
Iggy and the Stooges reinvented music as we know it.
We weren't like the other bands.
A feeling come over you with this great sound that we're making, and sometimes I would just hammer on my guitar.
I just started jumping up and down like baboons do before they're gonna fight. As soon as I started doing that, we were real communists. We lived in a communal house. We shared all money. And when we began to write songs, we shared authorship. When I was a little boy, the Ford Motor Company, they had a machine that engineered a drop, a mega claim. I thought we should get some of that in our songs.
We were just left without any adult supervision. I mean, we just did our thing.
We bumbled around America playing raggedly. Some gigs I could get it together to sing, some I couldn't, upsetting people wherever we went.
Thank you very much to the person who threw this glass bottle at my head. Nearly killed me, but you missed again. Keep trying next week.
Do you feel you influenced anybody?
I think I helped wipe out the 60s.
I don't want to belong to the glam people, alternative people, to any of it. I don't want to be a punk. I just want to be.
Please join me in welcoming Melena Ryzik and our very special guests, Jim Jarmusch and Jim Osterberg, Iggy Pop.
Everybody, thank you so much for joining us. I am so excited to be here with these two Jims.
Thanks, Melena.
I'm going to call you Iggy. This is about as cool as I'll ever feel, I think, right now. And I feel like probably some of you guys feel the same way, just being in this proximity. So you guys got a chance to watch the trailer, and we're going to talk a little bit about the movie, but I want to start by asking about how you guys got to know each other. I think it will surprise no one that you've known each other for a long time, and you met through mutual friends. But do you remember, what was it about that first meeting? What made you think, aha, this is somebody I'm going to be simpatico with?
I don't know if it was really like that. For me, it was like, oh man, that's Iggy Pop, you know? Because I had seen him play. I had never seen the Stooges in the old days, but I was a Stooges fan starting when I was 16, when the first record came out. And at first I was, you know, oh my God, it's Iggy Pop. But that went away really fast because we're Midwesterners and you don't need to bother with that kind of thing for very long, you know?
I'd seen his films, so, you know, wow, you know, it was like that. So. Wasn't really like cozy schmozy or anything. It was more like, oh, wow, you know.
And we had mutual musician friends, Dougie Bound, who played drums with Jim, and I was a friend of mine also, and other people as well.
Did I end up in your Coffee and Cigarettes film first? Was that the first thing we did, maybe?
Yes.
Yeah.
And then Dead Man was later.
He was working on Coffee and Cigarettes a long time ago. And I believe it was supposed to be a series of vignettes for MTV, and then cigarettes were the new enemy all of a sudden. So, whoa, you know. But it was made back when sort of like with this, really, it could have been anything. It wasn't necessarily going to be a feature film, was it, at first?
No, the first one I did was actually for Saturday Night Live, and they said, you want to do a five-minute thing? And I said, well, what does it have to be? And they said, well, hopefully it's funny, and you can own it after we show it on the show, and we have the rights to re-show that show, but we'll pay for it, and you can own it. And my friend Roberto Benigni happened to be in New York around that time, and I knew Stephen Wright, so I got those two maniacs together, and we made the first one for Saturday Night Live. And then I just kept making them because I wanted to make a series of them, and was so lucky because I was out in California, and I found out Jim was going to be there, and Tom Waits lives there. We were in Northern California, so I wrangled, I hoodwinked these two characters into doing it.
Yeah, we're going to watch a little bit of that later, and we'll talk more about it. You set it up for me so perfectly now, I almost feel like maybe we should watch it now. But should we talk more about Gimme Danger, guys, before we get to that? Okay. So Gimme Danger, Iggy, that was a movie that you wanted to get made, and you asked Jim to do that.
Yes, hey, will you make a movie about the Stooges? You know, it was really as simple as that.
And it okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Kind of about it.
Could have been starring Tom Hanks or anything. I don't know.
Oh, now you tell me.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, could have been anything. It was just, I believed in him. I believed in the group. So.
But he knew I'm a big Stooges fan and an Iggy fan, but the Stooges mean so much to me and always have. And he knew that, you know, that I would love to make a Stooges film. And the film, admittedly, is a celebration of the Stooges. I mean, I've read a few things where it seems like they wanted more warts. You know what I mean? Like, let's see the warts. Warts and all, you know, and I'm like, well, man, you know, one guy, we did an interview today, and he said, it seems like you put some makeup on the warts. And I said, no, I didn't put any makeup on him. I just didn't zoom into a super close-up of, look at that wart on his face, you know. All the nasty things that have happened, you know, they're not mentioned, some of them in the film, but you can read about them in Please Kill Me. You can find those things, you know. But that wasn't my job. I wanted to celebrate the Stooges.
Well, having grown up listening to them, growing up in Ohio, were the Stooges kind of your gateway outside of mainstream culture? Was that one of the first things you picked up?
Well, the Stooges were the first rock and roll thing that really spoke to a small group of me and friends, the MC5 and the Stooges, because yeah, we liked the Buffalo Springfield and the Jefferson Airplane. We liked the British stuff very much. But then there was this ass-kicking music from Detroit, from Michigan, that was industrial, working class, and very adventurous too, you know? And it was wild. And that was like, okay, we get this. This is ours, you know? So we appropriated it.
So did you have any trepidation about making the movie about something that you loved so much?
Yes, I did. I had a little trepidation about how to approach it and how much of my signature, because film is my chosen form of expression, but it's a bit different when I write something. And so, yeah, at first I wanted to make a film where there were just little subjects about the Stooges that I'd sort of string together. And then once we started, because we interrogated Jim for like 14 hours over 2 days or something, and that became, then I was editing the transcript on paper of how do I find a film in here, what should I do? And I kind of wanted to avoid chronology. But then once we started and the two editors, Adam Kernitz and Afonso Gonsalves, amazing editors and Stooges fans, they kind of convinced me, no, the most emotional way is to go chronological, starting with the demise, you know, which was my idea. So I had a little trepidation about it being a little, traditional in that way. But no, it was the right way to emotionally for the material, I think, so.
And Iggy, did you want to see it in the editing room? Did you fully give it over to Jim? Did you just say, whatever you want to do after the 14 hours I've given you?
I think probably the big thing I wanted to do without knowing it was I wanted to get a lot off my chest to somebody who had would listen and could do something with the process. But once that was decided, then because I create stuff myself, I made the decision not to ask him anything about what he was doing and never to hurry him, push him, you know. About every few months, I'd call up, hey, how's it going? You know, and I didn't really think in any, you know, I didn't sort of call him up and say, so, how are you doing working on the funding or anything, you know, anything like that. So I would have signed a release having not seen it, sight unseen. I would have, and I mentioned this to some of the professionals that protect me, said that, well, we should make up a really big contract for this guy to sign before you, and I just said, no. Because I trust him. So that, if you can trust someone, that's the first step to unleashing. You free them. You free them then to be them, really be themselves, and they'll dig deep. A human being will dig deep if you give them the freedom. It's scarier than the other thing where some guy's on the phone to you, okay, we got, you know, you said you'd have this done by September.
And that trust, I was so honored, you know, and I have to admit that when I did get almost final cut, almost done, and sent it to him, if he had said, yeah, this kind of sucks, you know, I would have put it away. No matter what money had gone in, I would not have put it out there, you know, so I wanted to make sure it was good with him too, but he gave me so much trust.
And it took many years to put this together, and you lost some of the people that are featured in it along the way.
Yeah. Yes.
So Iggy, how did it feel when you did finally see the finished product?
Well, you know, there had been a lot of commentary over the years about the group that kept coming back to our sins and our flops over and over. And I thought Jim hit the button right at the get-go. Not only were there sins and flops, but it sent them all back to their mothers. You know, and I saw that and I was terribly embarrassed. And I thought, oh my God, what is this? But I also recognized the truth there. And it's funny because in a way we foreshadowed what has become a millennial trend. You know, that's
going back to mom.
Going back to mom in those mid-20s, those difficult years, you know.
Well, millennials aren't doing it after they've been in a world-changing rock band, usually.
Yeah, right. Well, yeah, the Stooges, those three incredible records, you know. And then they're like 23 years old, 24 years old, and the world has said, yeah, we're through with you, you know.
You know, I never liked, and none of the other people in that band ever liked the sensible music that was being turned out and pushed at us through the music industry when we were kids. We didn't really like that stuff. It lacked childhood. But childhood is difficult to maintain when you grow the carapace that helps you get by in the world. But if that carapace becomes all there is, why bother to live or do anything? I think that's one of the problems of the group. And the film kind of plays with that, you know. And the music. The music was, I had a certain idealism in that I believed if we like it, people are going to like it. and I knew I was right. I didn't know it would take 39 to 45 years or several generations or, you know, whatever, you know, but I knew.
But, you know, they always put the, you know, progenitors of punk. They always, it's so easy to put punk there, you know. Yeah. And what you have to realize, and the film does discuss, is that they started as very experimental kind of noise rock without vocals, with invented instruments. They were influenced, whether they knew it or not, completely by the avant-garde music festivals in Ann Arbor, the Once Festival, where Morton Feldman and John Cage were presenting music, which was even by osmosis seeping into them and certainly into his interests as a young guy working at the at Discount Records, the record store.
Right, you worked at the college record shop.
What about the shop?
You worked at the college record shop. Did you make a lot of sales?
What?
Did you make a lot of sales?
I was good at selling singles to the kids after school, but they mainly, I was what you call a stock boy. In those days, there was a, about this high was where they kept the stock or the stuff they wanted people to buy, the racks. And then if somebody picked one out and took it to the counter to purchase it, it was my job to find its duplicate down by the floor. Get down there. And it's a really, after about 52 times, you know, your back hurts, and then you put it up there. And the other thing I did was what was called the returns. Until very recently, the record business has always been run on a consignment system. And they send the records to the record stores, and if they sell one, they'll pay for it to the record company. If they don't, if there's a, they come in boxes of 25, and if they don't tell 23 of those, the 23 goes back to the company. They've got to have somebody at that time to lick the noxious tape and repackage the stuff in the same box. So that was my job too, and get the coffee. And they would call me Iguana, too light with sugar, you know. So that was my job.
That was your start in the music business.
The guys, there was a guy working on his PhD in modern musical composition there. There was an Italian classical exchange pianist. There were rock and roll expert there who managed area groups and a guy who really knew the blues. And then they also stocked a lot of, there's a wonderful label out of New York called Verve Folkways, run by a man named Moses Ash. So I was 19 years old in 1966, and I'm looking at an album called Bedouin Music of the Southern Sinai and Touareg Medicine Chant. Wow, you know. What's that like? And it was great. It was great, the music. So I was listening to Nonesuch, that was Elektra Records' Everyman classical and folk label. Had a wonderful Gamelan record. It was a sampler called Music from the Morning of the World. Gamelan music is the gong music from Java and Bali. So, wow, what a place to be. And I sort of absorbed all this stuff, you know. College campus is good for a lot of, it's a theater, isn't it? And it's good for a lot of things besides getting an A through F, you know, or a sensible job.
And you continued, the Stooges continued playing shows. Even after you guys had released a couple records, you were playing shows on college campuses, high schools sometimes.
Yes, and often.
Can you guys imagine having the Stooges play in your high school gym?
We played junior highs, high schools, colleges, and often free, and sometimes maybe for a little money. But that was about it from the institutions, and then you'd get more if you played a ballroom or a bar or something.
But well, we have a clip from the movie that shows some of your early shows. Let's take a look.
Or not.
Yeah. Well, let's Let's, oh, there we go. All right.
Since we broke away for our message, Iggy has been in the crowd and out again three different times. They seem to be enjoying it, and so does he.
The group was always very aware of the theatrics of the moment, and they never moved, ever. In 40 minutes, the drummer would never look up, and the other two might move a foot or two.
We never knew what would happen, and so in the old days, you know, we just literally, I mean, it could be, we'd be out there, you know, and there's no vocal. You know, the guy's out in the crowd, he's down on the floor somewhere, you know, there's no vocal. So we're still going, you know, so until he starts singing, we don't do anything. And then, you know, eventually he'll climb back up and start singing. And that's, you know, it's all about, you know, working together to make a show.
You know, the way he works a gig, it reminds you that life, big time, is in the moment. Maybe most of it. But the moment is really intense about what's going down. He goes, you know, I feel like a short order cook. I got to get everybody's order. You want fries? You want shake? You know, he's going out in his mind. He says he's going to the crowd.
So again, you started playing music in high school. You had high school bands. And
yeah.
You talk about in the documentary that you had this, when you were starting out as a drummer, you had them put your drums on like a 15-foot, 16-foot riser. You had a sense of theatrics.
Well, I did. I did have a sense of, yeah, I mean.
So where did that come from at that age?
Well, I think some of it is from within. You know, hey. And some of it came from my observance, my observations that there was a big difference between the people who had that going for them with an audience and those that didn't. Especially after high school, I worked a teen club all summer called the Ponytail Club, Northern Michigan. We would, with the Iguanas, we played five sets a night, six nights a week. I had a cold water cabin with mattresses on the floor, $55 a week for each guy. And I would play drums, a group like the Four Tops would come through to plug their record. And I'd play drums behind them. They'd have one musician, and I was the pickup guy. And that was, you know, wow. You know, a beautiful, beautifully choreographed, confident show. And it would stun the audience, even though there was a cultural gap, because these were just little kids, little spud kids, you know, with money, their parents' money. Wow. But I also saw Bobby Goldsboro, who was a performer from the Mid-South who had a string of radio hits. And he came out in a suit with studs and the tie and everything. And his big stage move was that he could imitate a frog croaking. And the kids didn't go for it, you know. So there's a difference, you know. And there's stagecraft matters. And I was trying to get over, always. Trying to get over to the audience. So I just think that's fun and maybe also essential. I just had that feeling.
Do you remember the first times that you kind of leapt off the stage and went out into the crowd?
Yeah, I was working, playing. We were second or third bill, I think second bill to the Mothers of Invention. The Grandee, a psychedelic ballroom in Detroit. And the stage was not much higher than this. And it was an achievement to get people. They didn't have to approach the stage and come close to you, but a few started to. They were interested. And I was pretty impressed that, opening for the Mothers. The Mothers are very entertaining, were very entertaining at that time, and they had a sort of wit, that left an impression. I wanted us to make an impression too. So there were two young women laying on their backs in front of the stage, just watching it like this. And I thought, well, maybe I'll just like kid dive on top of them. Sounds like a good idea, I thought. And they were quicker than I imagined. So I lost a big hunk of my front tooth, and there was blood everywhere. It went through my lip. But, you know, little by little, the group made an impression. That was the first time. After that, I got a little cooler about it.
So you wanted to connect with audiences, obviously, and you wanted your music to be heard, but did you have a sense that you wanted to have a big audience? Did you ever want to be famous?
No, I always thought this at the time, and it hasn't changed essentially. I said to myself, for who we are, what we might have to offer, and you know how the unusual things in our approach and the simplicity in our musical foundations, there should be 50,000 people that would be interested in this. I had that figure in my mind right from the get-go. I don't know why. I didn't really understand that, you know, in the Big Bang theory of capitalist expansion, that's really not enough, but then enough is never enough, is it? You know? So, but that was what I thought. I thought, well, and with that, I thought, well, you could eat, you could have fun, we could go around and we could play our music, and that was sort of the hazy idea in my mind. I didn't go farther.
But I wanted to add one thing about, him basically inventing stage diving and going out, and also him bringing the audience on stage. It is not a scary thing. It is not, when I saw the Stooges, I never saw them original Stooges, but the reformed Stooges, it was an incredibly joyful thing of him breaking down that wall and everyone being the same and him representing us in the audience and bringing us up there. And it wasn't like, I don't know if you know who G.G. Allen was. It wasn't like a scary thing where, oh shit, he's coming out, I'm getting the fuck out. It was like, here he comes, yeah. And when he's going like that, it's not like, fuck you. It's like, we are all together, yeah! And you feel so good. I used to feel so high after seeing the Stooges, for several days of kind of joyful thing that he just broke it all down, Something very beautiful about him coming into the audience and making us all feel like we're all together, He's representing us, Anyway.
Thank you.
But it was very obvious when anyone knows who was there and saw me, what that feeling is.
Was that sensibility something that was familiar to you from your filmmaking? I mean, you are not somebody who went to make a Hollywood commercial film either. You had a different kind of take on things, and you stated that.
I think I have a similar thing of like, wow, if I could get several dozen people around the world to see my film, I'd be pretty, I got over, So I think that's sort of similar. Not looking for the, not looking for the big Steven Spielberg type of profile here. I don't know. Well, but the same thing, he said, we were making music that we wanted to believe in. And all the people I make films with, and it's the auteur theory is nonsense. You collaborate with people. And from the very start, we always want to make a film that we, making the film, would see, that would like to see, that we would appreciate. No. We're not doing demographic analysis. I'm more into the Bill Hicks thing of like the anti-marketing market. You know what I mean? Anyway.
But you had a challenge in making this film because there was not a lot of documentation because you were playing junior highs. There was nobody was out there.
That's a good point, Melena. Right?
Nobody was out there filming.
Junior high is cool. So cool to play the junior high, man.
But not only that, Stooges fans, right, are not the most reliable people with high-tech equipment, you know? You're talking stoners with a cassette player, and they're like, what do I do, man? Where do I point it? Is it on, you know? So there's not a lot of high-tech material. Does this thing, can this shoot? What do I do, you know, so.
So that was a challenge for you. It must have been putting together a documentary. And tell me how you approached it, because you went in a couple of different directions in terms of putting animation and things like that in the film.
Well, we knew from the start that we would have a lot of different textures in the film by the materials that we could uncover under every rock we could look. You know, we had really great people. Well, Ariel de Saint-Fall, who's here, she spent a year and a half just clearing a lot of stuff and tracking down photographers whose work we wanted and had discovered. And we had a lot of help. First, Jim hooked us up with whoever he knew that we could go to. And then a friend of ours, Ben Blackwell from Third Man Records, who's a collector of Stooges films and stuff, also guided us to a lot of people. John Sinclair's wife, Lenny Sinclair, had a lot of stuff. She was one of the few that shot the Stooges and the MC5, and she was very gracious, you know. And then we found some stuff, remarkably, that nobody's ever seen before. So we do have things in here that even hardcore Stooges fans have basically seen all this stuff, you know. So we use that too, but we do have photographs and film material no one's seen. And then we illustrated it in goofy ways. I mean, we were discussing this, me and the editors, a while ago, that, you know, rock and roll, if it doesn't have what we call a stupid factor, it's not really good rock and roll. And it's not derogatory. It's like, if you're just earnest, you are, sorry, you too. You know what I mean? And there's no, and we're dealing with a group named the Stooges, right? So we were free to illustrate it with clips from science fiction and old newsreels and commercials and whatever we could find. And then Carter Logan, our producer, we were looking for maybe some animation to have one more texture in there. I know a lot of it's kind of fashionable in these docs to have animation, but the hell with that. We found this amazing guy, James Kerr, in Montreal, who takes Renaissance paintings and uses the faces and makes very minimal animation. And we loved his stuff, so we asked him to, you know, there's not footage of Scott Ashton crashing the van into an overpass. There's not footage of the young, you know, Jim Osterberg curing marijuana in a dryer in the trailer park's laundromat, you know, so that he could take it to the Ashtons to convince them to rehearse, you know, these kind of things. So we got some nice animation things to illustrate those. So.
And of course, what you do have is the most amazing primary source. I was struck when watching the movie by your recall. I mean, the detail of stories that you remember. Did you keep a journal, or do you just have an amazing memory?
He's got an amazing memory. So when we were interviewing him, interrogating him, sometimes it would be, I'd be shocked because he'd say things like, oh yeah, now I remember Susie D'Onofrio was in my home room in eighth grade, and I remember going to her house, and her mother was hot. She had on this pink dress. It was June 14th, you know, like, well, how does he know this? How does he remember? I want this memory. Or maybe I don't, you know? But, I think he's just kind of a mutant. His brain and physical presence, it's not really normal. So.
Did the Stooges write anything down in terms of songwriting?
No. No, they would write, the only thing they wrote were things like, there was a wall called the Wall of Shame in the house. And after the gigs, we'd come home, and then Ron and Dave liked to stay up all night watching TV and even the fuzz on the TV, you know. And in the morning, I'd get up and there would be a sign like, see Iggy, see him puke, see him shit green. You know, it's just things like that, you know, weird pictures of film stars they liked, and then they'd scrawl graffiti. You know, it's strange, you know, sort of early graffiti. Yeah, but as far as our work, no. And I never wrote down the lyrics either. I did them all up here, and we never ever were recorded unless somebody happened to bootleg us or record a concert or recorded us in the studio. Most people didn't. There were bands like that in the area. They were very organized, and they had business managers and everything, and they would also have a four-track recorder in the rehearsal, and we were just play it over and over till we know it. It gets in a different way. So we weren't written down. It was an oral language.
Even the MC5, they didn't really record their rehearsals or anything.
I don't think so, no.
I love the MC5.
Is your songwriting any different now? Do you write things down now?
Yes. I started writing things down when I started doing Iggy Pop records. I actually, even on Raw Power, I would try to write. I would get about halfway into a lyric and I'd have it written down, and then I'd pass out and wake up or something like that. But even then, as now, I don't write it down. Like, it's not like this. It's like there's a line up here, and then there's some words that go down here, and then there's an arrow over to here, and then everything's crossed out, and it goes in a circle, and it, you know, it's like that. Because the whole thing is like, no, not that, this, no, how will I remember them? You know.
I do. Yeah, because I write my scripts, I write by hand.
Yeah, okay. Yeah,
and I write them and I cross things out, but I still want to be able to see what I crossed out. And I even want to see the stain of the coffee cup on my notebook. And I have arrows going everywhere because it's always a process. You know, I don't want to write on a computer and then, oh, well, I'm going to delete that part. But what if I then want that part? I can't remember. What you know, I want to keep it all in there in a messy way.
But a lot of the good stuff, just from with me, it just out it comes verbally, you know, even now.
And physically too, probably.
Sometimes, yeah. No, sometimes. Not all of it. Some of it is, you know, you need to know your positions, where you're gonna be in a given part of a song. There's craft and planning to what I do, more now maybe than then. We used to, before our gigs, we would just all go into this mode of frozen terror. You know, our first gigs was like, you know, like that. You know, and then when we do it, and it was sort of like a dream, you know, and gradually, you find ways to work with that, but that has never really left me. I always go through a kind of what I could only describe as mental illness, really, before I work. But I have a series of conventions and a routine, things to do, you know, that keep me from giving into that, you know. Go over the lyric, make sure you know every word, do some breathing exercises to hit the high note, do your stretches at this particular time, that sort of thing. You know, take off your shirt a half hour before, right? You know, just sort of change from the guy who wears the shirt to the guy who doesn't wear the shirt. You know, things like that.
All right, let's watch a clip of the guy who doesn't wear a shirt.
Handed Ron a guitar and I just said, you do it, I'm not that good at the music part. And Dave moved over on bass. Our manager came home and I improvised an angry song,
and began again. I had no way to express my anger to this guy who I never liked so much. I just started jumping up and down, like kind of the way chimps or baboons do before they're gonna fight, like that. And as soon as I started doing that, up went the Ashtons. The first time I ever saw those two guys powerfully motivated by something that wasn't an imitation of somebody else, something that was their own. In the Ashtons, I found primitive man.
Looks like fun.
So why a baboon? Why do you?
I don't know. It's just it was what occurred to me when Jim really did put pedal to the metal and interrogate me for like 10 hours, and at the time I didn't think I'm going to do a baboon number. I was moving in a certain way. It was coming from within. It had to do with their groove. And what I'd learned in college, Social Anthropology 101, Stone Age procedures, and then a little bit of what I was feeling. But whatever 49 years later or whatever it is, Jim asked about it, I used that description.
Do you dance like that to other people's music?
Yes. I do try to shake my booty to a little funk now and then, but it's really bad, you know.
Yeah. What kind of charge do you get now out of playing live?
Ooh, I get a big charge now and then, and then sometimes I play music now that it's a different kind, that I'll do a song that has a charge, either the Stooges stuff, some of which was co-written and some of which I wrote for the group. And so some of my harder rocking stuff, I'll get a personal charge. But more and more, you know, people used to come to see us and the back of the room looked just like a cardboard cutout. No one moved. And the front of the room was just kind of, I guess you could describe the atmosphere as stony. You know, there wasn't a lot of give back. People were just checking it out, not necessarily in a negative way. But now, people are physically with the beat and physically with the emotions. And it's just it's a really nice thing for me to witness. And I get just a big kick out of what they're doing as much or much more than what I'm doing. I just try to keep up at this point, really. That's about it.
I was at a show that you played a couple years ago in Brooklyn, and there was a kind of a lousy crowd, and they were not moving, and you gave them a talking to.
Well, good. Where was that? Was it a corporate?
It was in Williamsburg.
What? Yeah. Yeah. For Ray-Ban or something, yeah.
Maybe, yeah.
Yeah, well, you know, you do that. I'll give you a little shtick, you know.
They deserved it.
Yeah, that's okay.
And Jim, you play with a band. You kind of resumed playing with a band after having done music for many years. What do you get out of playing on stage?
Not much money. And we're not big wild, you know. On stage, we don't move around a lot. We have, you know, smoke machines. It's a drummer, when we're live, a drummer and two guitarists. And we, as the two guitarists, our big dramatic move will be the two of us come to the edge of the stage for a little
while. All right.
That's our big
the move, right, yeah.
But I remember a cool thing. Once I was with Joey Ramone. He was doing an interview, and the person asked him, So Joey, you know, you don't really, especially since maybe in the earlier days, but you don't really do anything on stage like, you know, Johnny and Dee Dee bounce around, but your big move is maybe you put your foot up on the monitor and lean forward. And he said, hey man, after Iggy Pop, what do you want me to do? You know, which I thought was kind of great. You know?
He did me for a couple of gigs when they started. I've seen old footage.
The early footage,
and that's
was
a really tall person doing me, and it's really unusual, you know. He looks, when he doesn't move, that's great. Wow, what a presence. What a presence. Yeah.
Did you feel like listening to this kind of music influenced your filmmaking style?
If what is influenced?
I'm asking Jim if listening to the Stooges or the Ramones, any of this kind of music influenced your filmmaking style.
Well, I don't know about style, but it influenced me as a person. It influenced me wanting to do what I want to do. It influenced me to trust my own priorities. It influenced me to not, and maybe this is also partly a Midwestern thing. I know he's the same. We aren't interested in hierarchies of art or expression. Like, I don't care if it's called low art or high art. If it moves you, you take it and it becomes part of you. It's valuable to you. And it doesn't matter if it's a comic book or if it's Caravaggio, or who was a street fighting maniac, by the way. You know, the Stooges definitely, because of what they did and who they are, and definitely is in me, you know, this inspires me. And, you know, they were really avant rock. I mean, they were doing very experimental things way back. They were not trying to be the Rolling Stones, you know? They were doing something. They started as the Psychedelic Stooges, a kind of no vocals, noise, very experimental stuff. And then, but their music always kept that primal thing. And I don't know how to say, but yes, they didn't influence my style as much as my, just as an inspiration. Does that make sense now?
Yeah.
And Iggy, you talked about when you were growing up liking sort of jingles, kind of advertising or short.
Absolutely.
And did that, was that a part of what made your songs, you know, your songwriting, your lyrics, your sound?
Yeah, especially the hooks.
Yeah.
They're hooklets. And they weren't, you know, they weren't fully blown flights of harmonic fancy, but they're catchy in a modest way. And, you know, for the song, I Want to Be Your Dog, it was as simple as Ron had a riff that went dun 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 dun. So I'd sing to that, and at some point, oh, how about if we just dun 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 dun, just a little rhythmic change, and then if I could sing the right words with that, we would have some articulation in the song. And I used to use that and repetition a lot from advertising and also Bo Diddley, you know. But like in 1969, over and over, I learned this on the debate team in high school. They tell you, tell them what you're going to tell them, and then tell them, and then tell them what you told them. So, you know, I use that technique a lot. So they get it, it'll get in there. You know?
I get no fun, my babe,
right.
No fun.
Right, yeah. Right.
That is a very concise description of a good song.
Yeah.
But I think a little too much, and we do it in the film too, it's a little too much to say that his lyrics are purely reductive like that, because, and a lot of great poetry is minimal. But he's written some incredible things, beautiful lyrics. I think one reason I wanted to call the film Gimme Danger is because the lyrics to the song Gimme Danger are so beautiful and dark, and really, it's a beautifully written song. You know, the language, the lyrics too, along with the riffs and the feeling of it. And He's written a lot of very beautiful things, I think, too. Down on the Street, some great lyrics.
There's usually an encounter in the lyric, you know, in I Want to Be Your Dog. I mean, I'm not just saying, hey, it'd be great if you come here. I'm saying, I want you here because I'm so messed up. But then now we're going to be face to face. Right there, you're dreaming of the encounter. And I think that puts a little action into the song. It's not just a musing at that point. And down on the street, you know, the faces are shining and you see a pretty thing and you don't want to be restricted in your appreciation of what's cool and what you want to go with in any way.
No walls.
No walls. So, you know, that's kind of how I think about it.
It reminds me a little bit, Jim, you once told me that your filmmaking approach is you can't get lost if you don't know where you're going.
Yes.
That's pretty good.
That's true, because, yeah, it's only partly a joke, you know. I really do follow that. I don't like to have, I have a kind of a plan, but I like to, you know, I only write one script. I don't revise my script. My next step is now I'm looking at locations, now I'm collaborating with a designer, now I'm working with the actors. I'm changing the script every day, and then we're shooting, I'm rewriting the script, and then what we shoot may be different, and then in the editing, we're changing the order of the scenes, or, you know, we're always finding it. So being lost, you know, is very helpful, I think, to a certain degree, and that's just my thing. There are other filmmakers that have a very distinct map, and they follow it very carefully, and they make beautiful things that way, but I could never do that. I don't use storyboards. I don't even use a shot list, even though before every scene we're going to shoot, the director of photography and myself have made a shot list for ourselves. But when we're there on the day, now we're going to shoot it, we throw that away. We keep some of it in our heads, but then, no, we're doing this on our feet now, you know? So it's still alive. It's just helpful for me to work that way.
Well, I promised you guys some coffee and cigarettes at the top of the talk. So
you can't smoke in here. You can't give them all cigarettes.
Let's watch a clip from the movie.
Hey, Tom. Hey. All right. I'm glad you can make it. You are here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, you know, you could call me Jim. I mean, you know, my friends call me Jim, or they call me Jimmy, or Iggy, or Jiggy. Call me Iggy. Call me Iggy. Yeah.
Okay, all right. Whichever way you're comfortable, I go either way, Jim or Iggy.
You call me Iggy.
Look, I'm sorry I'm late, Jim. Boy, whew. 4-car pileup. Oof. I delivered a baby this morning at about 9 o'clock. I was saving lives. I was out there on the highway. It was, you know, there's nothing worse than roadside surgery. You know, you don't have your own tools, and it's just, it's murder. I performed a tracheotomy with a ballpoint pen, and I've been busy.
Wait a minute. You're a doctor?
Yeah. I'm a doctor. I mean, music and medicine, really. It's really been my thing, is combining the two and living in that place where they overlap. A lot of people say it shows up in the music. You know, I don't know.
Well, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, okay. I can, the organization and the whole thing and the humanity, I guess. The humanity of the thing, sure. Regard.
Yeah, the
regard. Well, I guess it's a big day for you then.
It is. It was a medical morning.
Everybody's all right?
Everybody's fine.
Huh. Well,
you've been here a while, I see.
I've been here. Drinking a little coffee.
Yeah, I see you.
I ordered you some.
You ordered for me?
I mean, is it cool? Is that cool?
Yeah, okay. Coffee, yeah. Good for coffee.
Okay, man. Come on, have some coffee, yeah. Okay, coffee beers.
Iggy, how did it feel to be the straight man to Tom Waits?
Oh, you know, it was, I was so fascinated and just hoping to defend myself that it was, it freed me from, you know, it wasn't like acting in a movie or anything. Basically, it was just, you know, I was pretty astounded.
Had you not met before?
Well, not really. We'd met twice, once in L.A. a long time ago, and then we did a TV show in England together and actually finished a bottle of bourbon together, waiting to do our respective bits. So I knew him. But this was, you know, the way you do. This was written that way in broad strokes, and Jim here gave us the script, each of us, about quarter to midnight the night before an early shoot, right? You know? So I looked at it, I thought, oh, Christ, so I'm going to get beat up by Tom Waits, you know? And he looked at it, he's like, oh, where's the laughs? And I don't see any laughs in the damn thing, you know? What the hell? You know? So it was a great experience for me.
Did you have an approach in mind when you were going to direct these two, or did you just want to let them have at it?
Well, I had a script, and you know, some of it's in there, some of it's not, which I certainly encouraged. But I wasn't quite sure. You know, we were there on time, and Tom was late, and Tom had to go the next day to be on the Arsenio Hall show in L.A., and this was up Northern California. And Tom gets very, I've known him a long time, he gets very uptight before he has to do these kind of things. I think you're the same, this TV thing. And so Tom came in and we were sitting there and he kind of tossed the script that, it's true, I had not given them till late the night before. And Tom said, Jim, you said this was going to be funny, maybe you better just circle the jokes because I don't see any in there. And so Jim went out and said, I think I'll go outside and have a breath. So I decided, well, we're just going to use this feeling Tom has, because he's really a wonderful actor and we're friends. We've had fights before. Tom's the only person who's ever screamed at me, God damn it, Jim, I'm going to glue your fucking hair to the wall, which was a threat no one ever else used on me. So, but you know, we're okay with that. And so we kind of went with that. And it could have almost flipped around, because what if he was in a very bad mood and Tom was very, and Tom can be very open and, you know, it could have been the other way. But the script kind of was tilted a bit for Tom to be the surly one.
Yeah, and I mean, Tom was, you were doing videos for his also
yeah.
at the same time. And you know, when you're making a video, then you're starting to think, oh God, I suppose they want somebody to see the damn video. And you know, there's a budget and it gets into, you know, cranky territory.
Yeah, we had shot the video like the day, 2 days before. Yeah. And then now we were doing this the next day and in one day. And then Tom had to go to LA. And you know,
if you have to go to LA the next morning, that's always a bad feeling.
But I
always.
I agree always. With that one. I'm totally always. There with that. But you know, Tom was really, and there were things in, but I love the part later where he very generously tells Tom, wow, I met this drummer that I thought of you, he's really great, really hard and industrial. And Tom's reaction is like, so what are you saying? That drumming on my record sucks, or...
But this is Jim's creation. You created, yeah, but Tom, and I didn't just come up with that. Oh, no.
Okay. You know?
Somebody...
I also got in trouble because both of them had recently stopped smoking.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then I got calls from both of them for a few months after, like, you know. Well, thanks a lot. Now I'm smoking again, you know? Yeah. Like, well, I didn't tell you to inhale. And they're like, yeah. You know. But they were great. I love working with both of them. And he did a beautiful character in our film Dead Man with Billy Bob Thornton and Jared Harris, and really fantastic, which they also took my script and kind of improvised off of it and made it much, much better. And I love working with him, I got something up my sleeve to do with him again, and I love working with Tom also on anything, so.
Well, I bet that the audience has some questions for you, and we have a little bit of time for that, so we're gonna set up a couple of mics on either side, and if you guys wanna come to the mics, and then we'll kind of sort it out so that everybody can hear. So now we know that both of you guys, neither of you smoke anymore, right? You're drinking coffee still. What other advices have you given up?
Are you looking at me or Jim?
She's looking at you.
I don't do anything but wine, coffee. That's it. You know, senior pills. You know, nothing, no kicks there, you know.
Yeah, me too, the same. I found out some years ago I was allergic to red wine, and I wasn't a white wine drinker. So now my only thing is caffeine, dry white wine or very dry champagne I like, but I'm not a big alcohol guy, and I don't even... For a while, I don't even smoke the sacred herb, which is not permanent. I will smoke weed again someday, but for a while, I don't even smoke weed, so.
You guys are just clean living up here.
And we both do, like, Qigong. And
yeah, yeah.
Tai Chi, so.
All right.
Not together, but.
All right, we do have a question. Come on.
Yeah, this is for Iggy. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about your time in Berlin, living with David Bowie.
If I could just recall it.
Yeah, talk about your time with David Bowie.
Yeah, sum it up.
It was a large geographical area that looked a lot like Brooklyn before the Reconstruction, before the gentrification, with full of grouchy German draft dodgers, subsidized heavily by the German federal government, trying to keep the chance alive of a comeback someday. And you had a funny energy of like spy versus spy, and got Romanians named Reuven, and you know, guys who looked like Alec Guinness in a pork pie hat playing a spy, walking around, and you had leftover institutions from their great days. You had, you know, a fine Staatsopera, a fine theaters where you could still see a good Brecht production, really, really good. Nefertiti's head was there, it's still there, but at that time, I could touch her head. Now it's in one of those, like a Jason Bourne box, you know, to keep with laser protection and everything, yeah. So they had a lot of stuff from the Pergamon in Babylon, too. Beautiful things in that town. And yet, it was a kind of town at the time where in most of the town, you could walk three blocks and go to a corner cinema and see a triple feature for like a US dollar of fine movies, fine cinema. A lot of it old German cinema. So it's just no problem parking, you know? And it was the kind of place, if your associate from Hollywood came there, they would get nervous. And that's really good, you know. You kept that energy out. New Yorker would understand the place. Detroit people understood it, you know. So, sort of like that, a kind of a gray playground.
Can I do one follow-up question?
Okay, but quick.
Yep. How are you still alive?
We used to buy our flannel shirts at the supermarket. Yeah, it was like that, you know. Buy your. Yeah. Really.
Thank you.
Bilka.
Over here.
How you doing? DJ Rob Select. How you doing, Iggy Pop? I wanted to ask you this question. About 20 years ago, you decided to remix or reproduce Raw Power. What made you decide to do that?
Then he asked me why I did that.
Why did you remix Raw Power?
Remix Raw Power.
Yeah. Another copy. The master had been lost for a long time. A copy surfaced. It was proposed, if I didn't do it, somebody else was going to do it anyway. Once I did it, I wanted the music to get to more people at that time. And at that time, there were a lot of overweight guys with too many clothes playing something called nu metal and pumping iron and everything all over the U.S. And equating this sort of macho, bah, bah, this heaviness with raw energy. So I wanted them to be able to hear us. And you couldn't hear us. Those people couldn't hear us on the original mix because it was like a dog whistle that they just couldn't hear. So I just made it as loud and distorted as possible and put a big bottom in it, and it succeeded. And I knew the other mix would surface anyway, and I was true to I spent a lot of time putting in lots of extra lead guitar tracks. I actually turned my own vocal down. So that was why. I wanted the music to finally reach people after so many years of getting that. I was fucking fed up.
Thank you.
I have a two-part question for both of you. What is your opinion on the state of music today, and what type of music do you listen to now?
I couldn't hear
it. He wants to know what type of music you listen to now, and what do you think about the music scene now?
I listen to everything from Girlpool to Tenara Wen, which is a fine Touareg electrified desert band. Girlpool, I think you probably know who they are. I like U.S. Girls from Toronto very much. Just starting to listen to the Sadies because Jim hipped me to them. There's a young man who calls himself Prefuse 73, and he hails from Miami, but he's kind of hanging around New York too. Gold Panda, the Perfume Genius is wow. And then for hard bands, Death Grips, Destruction. Yeah, Death Grips is great. Destruction Unit, I like very much. But everybody's got to have a favorite. Now my favorite is Sleaford Mods.
Cool.
It's my favorite group, personally.
Wow.
You know, yeah. So I listen real widely. God, there's so many people. Jarek Bischoff for sort of what I would call sub-literate classical. And there are a lot of young people right now not bothering to learn score notation, but playing modern classical music with a classical attitude, you know. And Jarek Bischoff is one. A lot of great people out there. And I think there's more genuine recorded achievement out there right now than at any time that I know of. But it's just, you know how things are now. It's, how does anyone apprehend it all?
Thank you.
Sure.
Do you want to add any bands to that?
Well, I won't. I mean, I listen to so many things.
And Boris.
I
you
love
hippie
Boris.
To Boris, yeah. Right?
Well, I listen to so many different things. I listen to old English classical music from the 17th century to underground hip hop. You know, I just, there's so many interesting things out there. So, but he gave you a nice list, you know.
Yeah, that's a great Spotify playlist right there. All right.
And I listen to some even sort of mainstream things, like like Run the Jewels and Kendrick Lamar. But I love Sturgill Simpson. I listen to all kinds of stuff. So.
Kamasi Washington, and you could go on and on. Vince Staples, you know.
I like this band Nadja, this duo from Canada, drone duo Nadja. This would go on too long.
I think we got the picture. Yeah. All right. Over here.
So Avi. So here's sort of a New York question. So the rise of your solo career kind of paralleled the rise of Saturday Night Live. Yet I'm surprised. Have they ever asked you to perform live on it?
What about them?
Have you ever been asked to perform on Saturday Night Live?
No, that's never going to happen.
Do you want me to make a few calls? No?
What?
Do you want him to make a few calls?
Thank you.
I never laugh at the right jokes, you know?
Okay, over here.
Hi. I was wondering, you've obviously done a lot of documentary about the Stooges and spoken about the Stooges a lot. And obviously, this one's different because you're with Jim and you probably were more comfortable. But did at one point, did you ever see the Stooges in a different light? Because at this stage, did you remember stuff that was different, or did you yourself step back and see the band in a totally different light as you were talking to Jim?
She's talking to you.
To you.
She wants to know, did you have a different perspective on the band, on the Stooges, after having spent so much time being interrogated by Jim and thinking about this stuff?
And speaking at a different stage of your life.
It refreshed some of the perspectives that I've spent a lot of energy blocking out. Yeah. Some of the more vulnerable parts, you know, because nobody wants to live with their own vulnerabilities or the rips in the fabric of their lives all the time. So it dredged a lot of stuff up. And the first time I saw it, I have a very keenly developed paranoia. And that's, you know, the human thing. So there were all sorts of things I saw in the film. That guy's having a go at me, not you, but this guy saying this or this thing that, or what about that, you know, and gee whiz. And then the second time I saw it, then that was lessened. I saw it for a third time in Detroit the other night with a large audience, and it was gone. I didn't have any problems. And I was just, it's not, look, I don't know how to, any other way to, I'll just blurt out, it's just not a professional group thing. Yeah. It's just not. And it's just not. That's one perspective I have right now. But I think the ultimate value in music is, what does it do for the other people? That, you know, of course you do it for yourself, but it's the other people who have the power to give you of themselves, either by enjoying the music or being provoked by it in some way. And I see tremendous rewards and achievement from what that group did and still does, in a way, since there are recordings are still intact and available. So that's what I would say.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sure.
All right, we have time for these three more. Thank you.
those are the rewards. I was just wondering about the regrets along the way. So not just regretting I shouldn't have put peanut butter on myself at that show, but
hey. As
I mean, those perhaps are the cringeworthy elements, but what about, you know, as someone who survived, maybe I could have helped someone along the way, or perhaps I could have done something differently. So when you look back at some of the clips, what about some of the regrets?
Okay. That was already, I've already been dealing with those things, although I wouldn't call them regrets, before I asked Jim to make the film. That's been a karma in my life really since the century turned, since I hit about mid-50s. And my attitude has been this. I try to look around and see where I didn't get something done, try to get as much of it done now as I can. Try to get the whole job done if I can, rather than fussing over, oh my God, then if someone was hurt or I let down somebody, then what I try to do is do something for them without ever thinking that one makes up for the other, because it doesn't. But there is such a thing as balance, and there are scales in life. So that's what I would say. And, one thing that provoked me to do a lot of things for the group when we reunited was the fact that I thought, well, all right, I could have done better leading the group. It was not an easy group of people to lead, but that's not an excuse, and it was not an easy situation for us. So I'm sure that I did a great fucking job the second time around. And now this, yeah. So that's how I deal with that. That's what I'm trying to do.
Cool. So I think you both, as writers, draw a lot of influence from the energy of the street. And especially in New York, street energy, street culture has changed so much. I'm just wondering if you have to dig deeper for those influences, or if the influences have changed for you as writers.
What is she talking
about? Jim, why don't you start with
She's
that?
She's asking about influences from, like, the street.
From urban life.
And how New York has changed. And, yeah, I heard that the East Village might become the new Williamsburg. But, yeah, I don't know. You know, I have to say, I find New York very uninteresting. And I don't know. There are still interesting people here and people I love here. But I'm getting out of here, basically. I still live here part of the time, but I live up in the Catskills. And I'm more here than I am there, but that's flipping now. And I like being in a place where I can read and watch films and write and record music in my own place. And I'm in the woods, there are bears walking by, I mean, literally. And I just love that. Where I lived, I made an estimation of how many cars go by my house in an hour in the city.
Yeah.
And it's about 2,000. And where I am in the country, it's 3.
Yeah.
And also, I'm really tired of phone zombies, you know? Walking along with their glowing device. I am so tired of,
crack.
Like, get a life. You're in the present. You're in the world. Put that fucking thing away, you know? But, and you gotta shove them out of the way, because... And when you go to a concert, too, it's everything's the device now. It's like, wow, man, you're missing your whole life here. So I don't know, I'm kind of down on the city, which I love deeply, and it gave me so much energy in my life, but I feel like now it's been cashing it in on me, you know? So I just kind of I'm not real fond of this city right now. But. And it's not that it's changed so much, because I'm not nostalgic, and New York City is based on, you know, it's based on conning people out of their money from the starting in the no in the 17th century. I mean, let's face it, that's what New York is. That's not my problem. You know, I just think maybe there are too many people here, or their values are different. I don't know exactly. Gee, that was pretty negative. The city that I love.
Tell it.
I don't know. I mean, Iggy, are you looking for specific stories now as a writer? Are you drawing from, are there stories you want to tell as a writer now?
Are there stories that you want to tell as a writer now?
Where is what?
Are there stories you want to tell as a writer now? Thank you.
I would probably have to go into literature and become an alcoholic, which is a real danger for a writer. I've put out a lot of stuff this year. I put out 5 albums since I hit 60. That's a lot. So the last thing I really wanted to say was an album, the key song I wrote for the record I just put out, PP, Post-Pop Depression, and it was just about how I dream about going away to Paraguay. I haven't got anything new to say past that yet.
What a beautiful band that is, you know, man. That, you know.
You know, I've got to go this, wow.
Great music, so beautiful music, man.
Thanks.
Thank you. Okay, go ahead.
Hi, I am a spoken word artist on Borrowed Birds Records, and I've always been so curious, Iggy. Wow, this is so surreal. about the origins of the song Gimme Danger, and also Open Up and Bleed. I always just found these two songs very poetic, and even the melody and how the lyrics match the melody. So my question is, do you remember your songwriting process on those, or any memories on those two songs?
She's really interested in Open Up and Bleed and Gimme Danger, the songs, the melodies, the lyrics. Where did they, you know, are they from specific things? Do you have memories of where they came from?
Sure. Hey, thanks for asking. You seem like a nice person.
Thank you. Yeah. You too.
The key lines that were really within me in Gimme Danger are when I'm saying at the end of the verse, there's nothing in my dreams, just some ugly memories kiss me like the ocean breeze. Where that comes from is I was fresh in recovery from my first really nasty bout with being a shoot 'em up heroin junkie guy. And I had terrible, terrible memories of it. When I would dream at night, I would have terrible dreams. On the other hand, I intuited or felt, you know, love songs. It's a kind of love song. Love songs are something you can write, as if you have the privilege to be a music writer and a band or a nice theme. It was a minor theme with a kind of a descending. It's the same modality as I Want to Be Your Dog, musically. It's a particular mode. And so Kiss Me Like the Ocean Breeze came up because I had only recently felt the ocean breeze. I'm from the Midwest. When I was 23 and I went out to make Funhouse, I went to Santa Monica Beach. And I'd never felt the ocean breeze. It taps you. It puts a little tattoo on you. It's not just a, it's not a wind. It's not like a meadow breeze. It has this funny, insistent, tapping quality. It's just so beautiful. I loved it. So I was looking for that kind of a somebody that could make me feel better. And but on the other hand, there was a self-awareness there that unfortunately I didn't really go for the nice girls. You know, I went for the ooh. So, you know, so, and then there's a little S&M in there. I like a bit. That's about it.
Just for good measure.
Yeah. The open up and bleed was more, that was, by then I was in dire straits again. And I was, I didn't have a viable, nothing, no real career, but just fighting to keep making art, keep go out and doing some sort of appearance, some sort of show. And it was about that feeling that would overcome me when I, for some reason I would feel very uncomfortable and I would want to pierce my own skin. And I'm past that now, but I wasn't at the time. So again, it was just sort of a, you know, this kid recounting, they did this for me, to me, they did that to me. They did this, they did that, a kind of an indictment. And but the part that makes you want to open up and bleed is the things a man needs. Because those are the things, there are certain things that all human beings need that none of us are going to get most of the time. And everybody has to tailor life to those failures and yet to keep a hope of some thread that of emotional success. So that's kind of what I was getting to in the song. The bleeding is unfortunate. I do not recommend it.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you all for being such a great audience. I don't think I'm going to top that ever. So thank you guys for joining us.
Thank you all for being here
and asking such wonderful questions. I'm going to ask that these guys have got to get to a screening downtown, so I'm going to ask the audience to stay seated while they make their quick exit. And go everybody see Gimme Danger.
Thank you for coming.